Ed Schlossberg is truly a pioneer of interactive and interaction design, insofar as people working together to create a goal, to fulfill a goal. He's had some amazing ideas for children's museums and interactive spaces, including Sony Wonder and McCumber Farms and the Brooklyn Children's Museum, which is probably your oldest event and accomplishment. And of late, thanks to the technologies, he's been able to put a lot of what he had as vision into reality. And he's going to talk about some of that today. So please welcome Schlossberg.
Speaking both at the New York Times and at a design with a design background, in the design part of the company, what I wanted to do was basically give you a little bit of context into how this project happened, but also a little bit into why I wanted to do it. So, in 1969, a long time ago, I was working. I did a project with Buckminster Fuller at the New York Studio School, and I don't know if you know of Buckminster Fuller's work, but he, one of the things that he was very interested in was this idea of how to make the world more equitable for humanity and to try to figure out ways in which to explain the complexities of large-scale situations. And so we had this summer project at which we did at the New York Studio School. And at the time, composer Morton Feldman was the dean, which was really an amazing thing for him to do. And Morton, I don't know if you know about Morton Feldman, he was sort of one of the leaders of the Chance Music Composition School in New York. And so we did a world game for 8 weeks in the summer of 1969. And what the idea was to try to get 30 people to simulate that they were playing the world, in the sense of trying to figure out how to optimize world systems, global systems of distribution and communication and production. And it was a really interesting thing. And what I saw in that moment was how not so much the quality of the work that came out of it, because it was sort of trivial, because the only sources of information on a global level at that point in time were very poor, mostly United Nations and the World Monetary Fund. And so the data was really poor, but the effort of a part of 30 people playing together to accomplish something like modeling the world seemed to me to be a really interesting thing. So I thought that that's really cool. Then I was hired to design the Brooklyn Children's Museum 2 years later, which was amazingly fortuitous. And so I've designed a lot of interactive things because I didn't know any better. Because I, there was no place to study exhibit design in the world. Mostly exhibits had been designed by either graphic designers or architects. And so they either told stories or were formally beautiful, but never much more than that. And at the time, that was plenty. But when I did the Children's Museum, it seemed to me that I spoke to lots of people about constructivist learning and realized that it was learning by doing was much more interesting. And it seemed to me that what I really wanted to do was to make people interact with one another and also with the content in a context which will allow them to learn more about both, all three things. So I've progressively been doing a lot of children's museums. And then, but I could never really build a networked environment because the cost of computing and the cost of display technology and the cost of producing all this thing was prohibitive. Recently, in 2010, I designed the Shanghai Pavilion for the city of Shanghai, and I created an experience there where 500 people at a time came into a room, and their behavior by clapping their hands or waving their arms changed the the huge LED display on the outside of the building. And so I realized by doing that project that there was an opportunity now to actually create something where a large group could actually interact with one another and learn something from the interaction. And then, so I had a conversation with Senator Kennedy in 2004, because he was turning 70. And so he was thinking about retiring from the Senate or not running for another term, and so I thought for his birthday I would give him an idea about what he could do. And so I said, I think there should be an institute for the United States Senate where people could study the United States Senate. And so from that time until he passed away, we worked on trying to get that accomplished. And so the way that I modeled it was that I wanted to make it a place where 100 people could work together to try to pass the legislation in a particular day in history. So we picked different dates, like the date that the Compromise of 1850 was passed, and the civil rights legislation was passed, and a variety of other significant dates. And we built a platform so one of the things I thought about this was that this should be an environment where the sim, the content of the experience should be developed by high school and college students rather than, so I wanted to make it in a sense like an app environment where the app of the history of the experience could be developed by schools. And so that was one of the formalisms of it, because I wanted the whole idea to be as interdependent as possible, so that the creation of the content, then the play of the games, all depended on people working with one another in order to accomplish it. And since that, one little caveat, sort of parenthesis about that is, so the Senate and the Congress is a multiplayer game. and the idea is how to work together in a closed systems environment to fix a problem and to do it in a collaborative, collegial fashion if possible. And so I think that what I wanted to simulate was that. In other words, the Senate as a history document is much better learned in context with trying to behave as a senator than is learned as just a history lesson. So one of the things that I learned in doing these interactive experiences in museums is that if you can have a non-symbolic interface between you and the experience you want to have, you have a much better chance of internalizing it, because you're not thinking about a diagram which describes an idea, which describes a process, which then describes an outcome. You're just doing it all, you're synthesizing it all, because you are the vehicle of the resolution of the idea. And that's the potential for large-scale, in-person, multiplayer interactive experiences. So that's where this whole thing went to. And as President Obama said at the opening of this, he said, well, it's one thing to think about this idea, and it's quite another one to build an absolute replica of the Senate chamber and then do all the platforms and everything in order to realize it so that people could simulate the play of being a senator. But that's what we did. And one of the wonderful things was that this couldn't have, in a way, probably would have had a hard time happening if Senator Kennedy had lived, because the outpouring of affection for him and for respect for him made it very easy to raise the money to produce this project. So all the money that we needed for it was raised in about 18 months, which was amazing. So it was about a 3-year process to go from zero to opening this thing, 4-year process. And initially, I wanted my office and me to write the program for it rather than do all the design work. But we hired a pentagram to do the work for it. And unfortunately, the entire team of people who were working on it for the first 7 months left the firm. And so we were at a crossroads. So our office actually did all the design work because we couldn't really get another group of people to do it. So one other piece in the story is that we wanted to have a gallery experience, which it was more like a way of composing by moving linear fashion through a complex idea, because I think that the notion of having a linear flow in a space is very much like the process of time, which gives the experience a direction, which is really important. But so we created also a linear gallery experience, which sort of highlights experientially all the pieces, like how a bill becomes a law and the people of the Senate and the history of the Senate. So there are two parts to the building. And the building is really shaped like a square donut. In the center, in the hole, is an exact replica of the Senate chamber. And around it is the gallery. And around it are studios, which can look like either the cloakroom or the congressional hearing room or other parts of the Senate, so where people go and collect. And so the process of the day, of the 3 hours that people visit, is that they come in, they go into the Senate chamber, they're oriented to the process, they choose a senator that they want to be at that date and time, and then they have caucuses and go on and do the whole thing during the course of 3 hours. And then at the end of 3 hours, they see how they did compared to how the actual senators did in the date of that thing. And we've now created about 35 sims from 35 high schools and colleges around the U.S. And we open March 30th. No, that's not true. Yes. We open March 30th, sorry. And we have, you know, like, the nice thing is that we're book solid for the rest of the year already for the sim. But the gallery's open, you know, is also a good experience. So what I'd like to do is show you a very short intro film that give you a visual of the whole idea, and then walk through some images of people using it so that you can get a sense of it. And then I'd love to answer questions.
Do they have good preparatory work before they
get? Yeah. So the process of the experiences is that online people can. Well, let me play this and then I'll.
Edward M. Kennedy was a tireless visionary, a thoughtful bipartisan collaborator, and a proud senator committed to upholding the ideals of this great nation. As part of his dedication to public service, he conceived of a place where people could learn about the work of his beloved Senate and the critical role it plays in the nation and the world. Located at the University of Massachusetts, Boston, the Edward M. Kennedy Institute for the United States Senate will realize his vision and serve as a living memorial to the senator and his work. In this interactive environment, visitors will engage in individual and collaborative experiences that activate their understanding of the Senate and catalyze their commitment to public service. The multimedia content will showcase the dynamics of our democracy in real time and ensure that exhibits stay fresh and current. Visitors will also be able to access information that is meaningful to them and share information with each other and the world. For visitors that would like a more personal touch, student ambassadors from UMass and other universities will be there to facilitate and provide a vibrant connection to the community. One of the most exciting experiences at the ENK Institute will be a Senate simulation for middle and high school students. Our future leaders will become senators, debating, collaborating, and bringing legislation to a vote in the Institute's recreated Senate chamber. New simulations can be developed at any time, thanks to the open platform design. The ENK Institute will be a place of learning, collaboration, innovation, and above all, civic engagement. It will serve as an inspiration for students, teachers, community members, local and international visitors, and public servants for years to come.
So I don't know how dark this needs to be, but in here, let's see how deep it is. So it's on the UMass campus, but it's also directly next to the John F. Kennedy Library, Presidential
okay.
Library. So those two things now kind of are or seem to be perceived as one visit.
Is that on that's on your desktop?
It is. I don't know why it's not moving. Let me grab it. Whoa.
Ah.
That. Okay. It's at the end. How weird is that? Sorry.
You can scroll to the beginning on that side. Yeah,
yeah.
I think you can scroll back.
It's just taking me a little bit out of my... Oops. Sorry. So this is what it looks like now. And each of the columns that are sort of on the way to the entrance, or each one of them is for a state, and it has the name of it and when it joined the Union. And so it's...
Who was the architect?
Raphael Vignoli was the architect, who was a brilliant architect and one of the more impossible people in New York.
You mean he's an architect?
Yeah, not always.
Well, Narcissitech. So this is what it looks like as you enter into it. The Senate chamber is behind this, through the door right in the center of the building. And right over this, so you're going to the right, and this is where you get your ticket, and then you go and you get your tablet. And then there's about a 6-minute intro to the story of the place and how to use it. And then each of you pick to be a senator using your tablet by taking a picture of yourself and then choosing the state that you want to represent. And then this is the gallery environment. And this was designed rather uniquely in the sense that there are no there's no physical objects in the gallery. It's only the projectors on a wall. And so one of the challenges in building this thing was to build something where the wireless connection between the tablet could be used by 1,000 people, up to 1,000 people in the room without any loss of control or dropout or whatever, which was a challenge. But what we succeeded at it. So the reason why that's important is because you really want to both feel as if you're in, a person wants to feel that they're in control, but they also want to feel as if they're part of something. And so the thing that's so fantastic about contemporary technology is that it, in a sense, it's yours. And so the minute you're handed it, then you want to be able to control the things around you. And so we use the tablets as the going farther than what you see on the wall, or communicating with other senators, or doing research about the subject, or storing your questions or things you want to do, or there's a kind of point system that as a senator, you get points for collaboration, and you get points for how close to reality you were, and a variety of other things. So this is moving along this wall, and this is how a bill becomes a law, and you can question anything you see right on the tablet. There's also staff there, and then this is a kind of cool thing with all the senators that have, all the people that have ever been senators by year. And so you can see all the senators from every state, and when states join the union, et cetera, so you can see that whole history of that. And then if you call up any particular person, then you can get their Senate history, and if you want to go into all the bills that they proposed or are, so it's pretty deep. And then we actually recreated Senator Kennedy's office in the corner of the building from his Senate office in Washington. So this is a really nice thing, which has, this is his, what his office actually looked like, and all the artifacts are exactly what were in there. So this is the only thing that is sort of memorial-like in the place. The thing that he was so excited about this project, and I think, he was such a, I don't mean player in the way people talk about player, but he was so in the moment of being part of compromise and making things happen, and that that this project was really good because it kind of activated everyone to not be an abstract senator, but to be a player in the process. So you can have a point of view about a particular senator, but you have a very different perspective on it once you've put on the persona of being a senator and saw how difficult it is to get people to want to do what you want, and how you have to give and take to make that happen. So the process of coming here is typically it's a class of 30 or more kids who come, and they can sign up in advance, and they're downloaded a whole thing about what the process is and what's going to happen to you and what you can do and how it works. And then, so you're coming with a preview experience of what it's like. This is a short film and a variety of things you can do.
And so typically they've already chosen a bill that they're going to
selected one of, we have it, it's sort of offered in two ways. We have, if you have 100 people, you get to choose whatever you want that, mm-hmm. for that thing. If you're not 100 people, you can make a suggestion for what happens, and depending on who comes, you might. So there are 30 different sims, mm-hmm. And some of them are in 2006 and 2008, and some of them are in 1850, mm-hmm. and et cetera. So it's really cute, as you can hear that they're 365 days a year, many years, so there are lots of sims to be produced. So sure. We think it's a cool thing because people can develop many of them. And so we've got now 100 schools signed up for the rest of this year to start developing sims for the future. And we were talking about how things work. The great thing about this is that this is audience training, this process. In other words, by developing a sim, you definitely want to go into play.
Yeah.
So I think in contemporary life, that's just like developing an app. You want to then tell all of your friends to use it. So the whole idea of doing it this way was to make sure that we were, that the the art of this experience was in the collaboration, mm-hmm. not in the building itself. The building was just the context in which it happened. And these are some, there's a whole story of all the legislation that Senator Kennedy passed. And this is a, another game about how a bill becomes a law, and the people really like, and it's about ice cream, and it's interesting. And then there are all, then there are Senate milestones of, in a sense, legislation that's been really hugely important. And then about today's Senate, there's actually a live feed from the Senate chamber and from the cloakroom, and you can see all the bills that are currently on the floor.
Can you say more about the cloakroom?
Well, the cloakroom is just one of the places where a lot of deals are made. And so the reason is that it kind of only fits a few, relatively few people, and there are not a lot of doors in and out of it. So it's something where, so it just, one of the things that's really interesting is that this is a situational environment. So if you want to talk to one person and convince them about doing something, it's more likely if you go to the cloakroom, they'll be able to do that. So that's why people actually went to the cloakroom or went to the caucus room, whatever. And then at the end, you can make a difference and talk about things that you'd like to follow up on. And then you can talk about today's vote. And so this is how the sim works. So this is your entering into the chamber. Again, it's a complete recreation of the Senate chamber. The desk, the model of the desk is a little bit simplified from the, what the real desks look like in this chamber, but and then there, in many of the desks, there are things in it like the signatures of certain photographs of the signatures of senators who had sat there, mm-hmm. so that you can get some sense of history. And there's a gallery for 300 people, as there is in the real Senate from above. So the people who go in the gallery then can go upstairs and watch the Senate being in with the people who are doing the sim can watch that. And it was really nice because Senator Biden opened up the first use of the sim at the opening. So that was, so these are the process, and there's a facilitator who is facilitates the play of the simulation and the negotiations and the trading, and then this is one of the caucus rooms where people are negotiating for a deal and then making a decision on how they're all going to vote and then trying to convince other people to vote with them. So there's an element in it which is in a sense game-like, in the sense that there are moments, and there are moments of decision-making, moments of collaboration, moments of that, and with an overall outcome, which is how the Senate's going to vote that day, and then comparing it to the historic vote. And people get to pitch and talk in front of the Senate to do that.
How do they decide who's going to be the speakers?
They decide, they do it in caucus. So this is what it all looks like. And I took this picture because we did 6 months of basically playtesting of this environment before we opened. And the only way I could figure out to judge whether or not this was working was to ask the teachers who brought the kids for the testing whether or not, was there talk about the experience in the bus going home? Because if there was, then we had succeeded.
Right. Yeah.
And so the bus has become a symbol, that was sort of our evaluation program.
So you didn't hide microphones in the bus?
No. No. So maybe we can up the lights. And
okay.
So how did you choose which bills to work
with? We have a, so one of the things that might be on your mind is that we're having high school kids and their teachers write the sim. But what we realized was that we needed a historic a committee to review all the sims before they were, to make sure that they were historically accurate. So we have a committee of about 40 former senators and Senate historians and historians who evaluate and check all the work that's done. Mm-hmm.
Are there a range of bills, so like, would there be like the Volstead Act or something?
Yeah,
like that?
But the way that it was, this group of 40 people selected the first 40 days that we would ask people to do a sim about, because they were really significant days in the history of the Senate. Mm-hmm. Like the passage of Civil Rights Act, the passage of 1850, well, you know, a lot of things where it was really, really important legislation.
Is the platform design, so creating the sim is just a step-by-step narrative process?
Yes.
Kind of and it's meant to reflect the actual history, right?
Yes. No, it does reflect the actual history.
And it does reflect the history, except for the actual votes, I guess.
Well, no, you don't know how people voted, but you know.
But the process.
Yes.
And the steps are recreated.
Right. And newspapers of the day are part of the data field, and any broadsides or documents, and also speeches from the state legislatures of the states which were most involved with the bill. Mm-hmm. So there's a huge data field behind it that people could search on to find out what was going on.
Mm-hmm. But do the students have to follow that data field, or can they diverge? Can they?
They don't have
vote
to
down the bill. That
no, they can. That's it. Basically, I mean, they're encouraged to not bullshit. In other words, they're encouraged to look beyond what they know, mm-hmm, or what they hear, and most of them do, because they have to get up and argue a bill. So everyone has the opportunity of arguing. So if they can't make an argument because they've never really looked at the stuff, so it's really interesting. And the engagement of the kids and the excitement, and especially giving speeches in that, being in that chamber really creeps people out. I mean, not in a haunted house feeling, but like that most people have never been in. Very few people have been on the Senate floor. So walking into it and being on it is actually really powerful, even for teenagers, I wasn't sure.
So there's mostly high school kids.
Mostly high
school. You don't go below high school.
No.
From start to finish, how long would you talk?
Two and a half to 3 hours.
The playtesting you did, the 6 months, was that with kids as well?
Yes. Yeah. And adults, actually. We did playtesting with adults, because we wanted to, one of the things that is going to happen this summer is new Senate staff will be playing this.
Oh.
So it'll be, because the Senate is very involved with this project, and so all the senators are sending their staff here to do simulations.
It seems like you could use this as a laboratory for improving the UX of the actual Senate itself. I feel like they should all have those tablets.
Right. Well, I think that the cool thing is that it's designed to be a heuristic tool, and so it can be used in lots of ways. And we're still, we'll do a 6-month evaluation on, are there any sticking points? Is there any places where people get confused? Because you get a complete diagnostic history off of the tablets of where people died or whatever, where they froze, they couldn't do anything, they didn't know what to do, so. Mm-hmm. That's the astonishing thing about having this all on a platform.
So separate from the schools that develop the sims, but who come there, do they tend to build a curriculum around?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, now they will be.
Right.
But the nice thing about this is we're also, in summer months, we're going to have we're going to try some schools who are going to come every day and do five days of just to see how that goes. Mm-hmm. So where they stay being the same senator for a period of time. Because we have five days in a row of sims of 1 year.
Wow.
So we could have that kind of simulation.
Are log jams built into the sims?
Well, they come because you can't get people to go along with you. I mean,
you don't need to build them in.
you don't need, because it's like it's real life.
So the Senate staff that's coming for this summer.
Yeah.
Are you doing special things for them, or is it going to be?
No, we're going to. They'll do this. They'll probably go faster through it. Hopefully, a little bit. Maybe not.
Yeah.
We'll see. Maybe slower.
How do the votes in real life? Like, how do they track with historically? Have you learned anything from that?
It's interesting. It's pretty close, especially with things where people can model the controversy with it, the sort of civil rights things. Mm-hmm. There's a sim about passing a law that did not allow slave auctions to be in the city of Washington, D.C. We've had a mixed racial audience every time. And it's always been almost exactly the same vote as the real vote. So, and having sort of white and black and Hispanic kids arguing on both on sides that they disagreed with is really, I think, that kind of thing is really interesting. I mean, it's like debate societies and stuff like that, but this is, I have to say that it's very hard it is very hard to see how having 100 people working together to solve a problem, how complicated that is. And you can imagine it as an individual, but participating in it is really powerful, because it's like, this is no joke. How am I going to get 50 other people to agree with me?
And do they actually get to the level of, it'd be hard to sort of have real deal making go on?
Well, sort of, yeah.
I mean, do they know what votes are... a lot of these things are done through trades.
No, but there's always more. We picked days where there was more than one vote.
Oh, okay.
So there's several votes coming up. So there's like the morning vote, which would, I'm making this up, let's say it was less controversial.
Mm-hmm.
But the two afternoon votes are much worse, or much, much harder.
So you have the opportunity to trade your
vote.
Yeah,
and that's part of how it's... you're told about it,
yeah,
which is,
yeah.
You're only here for a day, but it's like you're here for a day.
Yeah.
And so it's not just one bill. And so,
mm-hmm. Oh, so it's multiple, so
yeah,
you're, it's all
yeah,
day.
Yeah, so we always pick days where there was more than one bill of,
mm-hmm.
one bill of substance, and two or three other bills that were coming up. And that, because from your own experience, that's why we did it, because if you only did one bill,
yeah,
you wouldn't get a model of what it meant,
right,
to compromise,
really,
and you wouldn't have anything to trade.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering about, the trading.
That's great.
So do kids come away with a respect for the process,
yeah,
or do they, or is there a frustration that, is this really the best way to...
I think that the difference is that they're not abstracting themselves. They're not abstracting the process to something at a distance.
Yeah, they're doing
so
it.
So they're doing it. So
yeah.
It's like, is football a good game? You know, sitting in the stands.
Yeah.
But if you're in it, it's a good game. I mean,
yeah,
it's fun,
yeah,
to play. Or football is maybe not a good analogy, but well, all I mean is that it's very interesting to be, in a sense, putting on a persona and a set of responsibilities, and then trying to behave as you would want to behave, and then
I just wonder how kids who are actually, yeah, high school students are aware of what's going on in the world,
yeah,
and they're aware that the Senate for the past 2 years has not been terribly, actually it's more Congress than Senate, so maybe the Senate.
But the Senate has sucked also. I mean.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
So
how do they connect the reality of the inability to?
But the idea of having a voice in a process,
yeah,
is very empowering.
Yeah.
So even if they lose the bill, there's still,
yeah,
a sense of empowerment.
Right.
So given your own history, working with groups of people to make things happen, how close is this to the ultimate dream you've had?
Well, I think a lot of things. One of the things I really feel is this is a particularly good thing to do a simulation of, because it's very hard to understand what the issues are and what people are confronted with when they want to pass a bill. It's, and I think it's nearly impossible to you know, to see some AV thing that, you know, like, and then the, you know, sort of like a single point narrative. The problem with contemporary life is multi-point narrative. And we tend to do things as single point narratives about how to explain it.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is a way in which you're not explaining from a privileged point of view. You're being explained, you're having to figure it out from the point of view of someone doing it in an environment where it's 99 other people participating. So it's really challenging.
So have you thought about, I mean, you could obviously, you could do, you know, traditional system, Sims, that
yes.
would be interesting.
Yes.
I mean, are any of those, what are the other ones you've thought about? Are any of them, you know, real possibilities?
Well, we're actually, we're doing two other projects.
Yeah.
One of them is about how to get innovation into a hospital, which is really interesting.
Yeah.
Because the problem often with innovation is not the innovation, but it has to do with the way the system processes and evaluates information, or who introduces the idea, or many things. So if you can see that as a process,
that's great. We should need to, because I always have this argument here that, like, we keep setting up groups of people to come up with new ideas, and my feeling is always, we don't need any, we got a billion ideas, we need a process for selecting and actually executing them. We don't need more ideas put into this massive pool.
Right.
And so that's your, yeah, but we don't have, we've never really, you know, we've never really solved that problem. We keep thinking we need, you know, we're looking for the magic bullet, so we just need to keep generating ideas. It's just very frustrating.
What's the second idea?
We're making a model of an economy for both learning about how a small town economy works and how it works for you, or doesn't work for you. Because the thing is that people think of their money in relationship only to their issues, and not in relationship to an economy. And so we're doing a simulation of a town. And this will be for...
Yeah. That's why we wrote down taxes all the time.
This is maybe about 50
people.
Taxes are bad for me.
Who's funding that? Who's the...
I can't tell you.
Very cool idea.
When the kids leave their day or days, is there some sort of access or document, like, to kind of, is it just the experience that they're taking away, or is there some other kind of data that they can access?
Well, not attributed to names, but every Sim's, results of every Sim.
Right.
So you can look back on and say, November 3rd,
right.
in the afternoon,
yeah.
this was the result of the Sim. This was the result of the Sim. So your Sim, you could know about your Sim, but we couldn't have names associated with it.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no. So we wiped the, you know, what your name is off every day.
What type of people make up that committee that oversees the historical accuracy?
There are about eight Senate former senators and Senate staff. And then there are a number of people like McCullough and other sort of political historians who are on the committee.
Questions?
I think this is a tool that could be used in lots of circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
But it takes it's not trivial to go from the aspiration of it to figure out what the play is.
Yeah, yeah. It's massively complicated. Reality is very complicated.
Yeah.
I wonder, it seems like for this particular scenario, obviously, like you said, the environment itself and the Senate floor is so integral to it. You become, it's like a method acting exercise.
Yeah, well, it validates it.
Yeah, and then you also have this infrastructure that you've built around it to facilitate that process. And you mentioned in the video that it was an open platform.
Right.
And I'm wondering, is there any thought to trying to apply that specific solution? I mean, maybe it's too specific and it's too Senate specific, but could you engineer something?
I think the architecture could be used. I don't think there's a place beyond which the architecture would have to.
Yeah.
In a sense, the communication layer would have to be configured to the situation that you were describing.
Right.
Because this is really configured to in a sense, simulating the, what the communication issues are that happen in the Senate.
Right. Yeah, because I'm thinking just consensus, like maybe to Tom's point earlier, consensus
yeah.
building in general and factions, and is there a way to, maybe there's learnings even out of this tool in the way that
Definitely.
It's used to
Well, we expect that to be the case.
Yeah.
I mean, we have to run it for it. This
yeah.
is the kind of thing
Needs
where you have
data.
To run it. I mean, again, March 30th, so
yeah.
we haven't had that much testing yet.
Do you have a rough idea of how much of the time or effort went into actually accumulating the data set?
It seems that it's taken the schools somewhere between 3 and 5 months to do that,
mm-hmm.
to finish a sim.
Wow. That's
with a class as the group size.
Right.
And what are they providing you?
They're providing, so it's a structured document. It says, you know, we need all the newspapers that you can find in the city, in these cities. We need the records of the legislatures. We need, you know, and so it shows you all the things you need and where you put them. And then, you know, and the speeches and a variety of things. And any books that were kind of important to the story. And we provide a background of, you know, like the Compromise of 1850, I keep repeating that because that was the first one we did. But like all the, you know, were there any books at the time which were really important? Were there any speakers? Who are they? So we provide that as a background document that you get as part of the what's called the, you know, the simulation development kit, SDK. Mm-hmm.
And then they have to do legwork to
yes.
handle it.
Yeah.
So that sends them to libraries and to archives and to...
Yeah.
Libraries?
Well, probably.
Places with the
New York Public Library. I mean, not much would be in a local library.
Yeah. Yeah. I assume they go online.
Well, yeah, of course. But a lot of the interesting, you know, that's a lot of that stuff isn't online. So we've chosen things where there
where
was...
Where they have to actually.
Where there is enough, where we kind of know that there's enough...
Kind of like a treasure
hunt. Yeah. But it's like the cool thing, you know, like a kid doing that and then knowing that that would go into this, which then they could go and simulate in. It's cool.
Thank you, Ed. That was great. Interesting.
Fantastic.
Yeah, thank you.
So, do you accept people that just come in off the street?
Yeah. Well, unless it's full.
It's cool.
So you can join an existing group? I mean, how do you get the 100?
You could, you